study objectives, design, the results of the study, and modeling. And for me, modeling is really the meat of the presentation. I see there's a few people here that are from maybe out of DM branch, so they maybe haven't seen previous seminars. So I'll give you the 2-minute rundown on hydrus, basically, which is the model that, that we are looking at here. Basically, we were looking around in 2008 for a model to simulate fumigant transport in soils and volatilization. None of the models were really had all the capabilities that we wanted, but there was one vadozone model that had potential, and that was hydrus. What hydrus is a model that simulates heat, water, and solute transport in 1, 2, or 3 dimensions. So we looked at the model and came up with several modifications that we'd like to see made to the model. For example, it didn't have the full capability it needed to simulate the tarp. And tarps are common in fumigations, as you might know. And particularly if you have, for example, a bedded tarp application where a part of the surface is tarped and part is untarped, it's really important to be able to simulate those kinds of management practices. So we developed a contract with the model's author, Jurka Simeonek, professor at UC Riverside. And over the next couple of years, we negotiated changes in the model. Jurka would make changes. He'd ship it back to us. We'd do error testing on the model and come back with further modifications. Bottom line is now we feel like we have something that has at least many of the capabilities we would want to see in a vadozone model to simulate fumigant transport. So one of the objectives of this study was to evaluate or compare the model to our current method of estimating fumigant emissions and see how it performed. So the lost field study, this was a really complex study. And by my count, over 30 people at least participated, including people from Environmental Monitoring's air group, as well as groundwater, certain personnel from the groundwater and surface water groups. So I wanted to acknowledge everybody. First of all, this is a list of all the EM staff that participated, and forgive me if I forgot somebody. I may well have done that. My memory's not as good as it used to be. And also, there were some other groups that collaborated with us. In particular, USDA Agricultural Research Service, Sudhwan Gao and her staff, University of California, Davis, Hussein Ajwa and his staff. Tri-Cal was instrumental in lining up the field and orchestrating the applications. We had 3 different rigs running simultaneously in 3 fields. Sullivan Consulting, he's a consultant that does oversees fumigant studies for registrants, and some anonymous Kern County grower. I'd like to give particular thanks to Sudhwan because without her gas, soil gas concentration, it would have been really much more difficult to evaluate the model. Secondly, I'd like to give special thanks to Etach Tuli for really doing a nice job in setting up the soil sampling and field study. And particularly, I wanted to thank Bruce Johnson for the various discussions we've had over the last 6 months or so, because there were a lot of issues that came up with the data. So background, we'll talk a little bit about tarp types and permeabilities, study objectives, what were the objectives of the study, how was it designed, what was the sampling. I'll summarize the field estimated fluxes. These are the fluxes that we got out of the study using standard or conventional inverse modeling or back calculated techniques. Then I'll move into, again, what I call the meat of the presentation, the hydrus modeling. Number one, calibration, and you'll notice I put, quote, validation in quotes because this is not really a standard validation exercise. When we think of model validation, typically we're thinking of comparing model output to measured values. In this particular exercise here, there are no measured fluxes. We're measuring air concentrations and we're modeling the fluxes using a dispersion model. And then conclusions. So first, a little bit on terminology to make sure we're all on the same page. The rate of volatilization of a fumigant, we talk about flux density. When we talk about this, we're usually talking about some average value over a sampling period, say 6 hours or 12 hours. Second, cumulative flux is the total amount of fumigants volatilized per unit area of soil of the field. Emission ratio is the fraction of volatilized, which is expressed as a fraction of the applied fumigant. And finally, mass transfer coefficient. This is a parameter that describes how leaky a tarp is with respect to a fumigant. So if you apply a fumigant and you put a soil, tarp down that has a very high mass transfer coefficient, that's a really leaky tarp, and it's not going to hold the fumigant into the soil. If you put have an application with a really low mass transfer coefficient for the tarp-fumigant combination, then that tarp tends to hold the fumigant down in the soil. It's not very leaky. Yeah? They're measured. I had that slide in here. I took it out because I thought it was too long. It's really pretty simple. What they do in the laboratory is they take a chamber that's split in half and it's bisected by the tarp. And they inject fumigant into one half of the chamber, and then they monitor over time the concentrations in both parts of the chamber. So what happens is, if you were to think of time on this axis and concentration here, basically the concentrations go like this because they reach equilibrium. What's happening is the fumigant's permeating through the tarp, and then there's an equation you fit that to get the first order mass transfer coefficient. So back to tarps, there are several different kinds of tarps, low-density polyethylene and high-density polyethylene, metallized tarps, which I believe are not used in California, and VIF and TIF tarps, where VIF stands for virtually impermeable film and TIF stands for totally impermeable film. If we look at some of the mass transfer coefficients that have been measured using the technique that I just mentioned, this is data for 1-3-D mass transfer coefficients by tarp type. The y-axis is a log axis. So you can see between polyethylene, virtually impermeable, and so-called totally impermeable, there's a orders of magnitude difference in the permeabilities of the tarps. So in other words, a totally impermeable tarp, it's pretty easy to show using back-of-the-envelope calculations that with mass transfer coefficients this low, that you're really going to have almost an impermeable film. If we go out in the field and measure after an application, measure air concentrations, we're going to find, in most cases, we would expect to find air concentrations that would be below the limit of detection. However, we know that this is not really the case on the basis of at least one field study. So the problem that I'm alluding to here is the correspondence of laboratory measured mass transfer coefficients to what actually happens in the field, where when you apply the tarp, you may stretch it, you may put holes in it, the tarp weathers. So totally impermeable is in fact not totally impermeable. We just don't have a lot of good field data for totally impermeable tarps. The second problem is if you have a tarp that's has very, very low permeability that tends to hold the fumigant in the soil, is that when you finally cut the tarp, you have this potential for a really high flush of fumigant. So this is not a good thing because there's a potential for bystander exposure or worker exposures. So the conventional time for currently on fumigant labels for tarp cutting is 5 days. It's apparent, though, that we probably need to have a longer time required between application and subsequent tarp cutting. So with that as background, the study objectives were, first of all, to gather field data for PIC or chloropicrin and 1,3-D flux under a TIF or totally impermeable film broadcast application. And one of the things is we're interested in understanding how the flux data compare with lab predictions. Secondly, evaluate post-tarp cut peak fluxes, that flush we were talking about, as a function of tarp cutting time. And the goal here from a regulatory standpoint is to understand or come up with some data to support a decision on what would be the minimum tarp holding time that we could allow to ensure that no buffer zone is required at the time of tarp cut. And finally, again, hydrous validation, which is basically just a comparison of hydrous simulated and field estimated fluxes. So this is just kind of an overview of the experimental setup. There were three different fields. Field one was an 8-acre field. Nice. And we had 16 air samplers around the field. Now these are off-site air samplers. They're not on the field, they're away from it. The purpose of the air samplers is to allow back calculation of the of the flux for that field from the measured air concentrations from those samplers. The tarp cut time on field one was 16 days. The second field was 2 acres up there on the right-hand side. And by the way, this is just a pictorial. The fields were actually separated by large distances so that fluxes from one did not influence the air concentrations at another. I believe field one was a mile from the other two fields, and those other two fields were 280 or 300 meters apart, if my memory serves. So field two was a 2-acre field, 8 air samplers for this field. Because it's smaller, it did not require as many air samplers. Tarp cut time was not 16 days. Tarp cut time was 10 days for field two. And field three was identical to field two, except tarp cut time was 5 days. The air sampling occurred for 6-hour intervals from the time at each one of the samplers, for the time immediately after application to for 2 days, and then went to 12-hour intervals. Then at the time of tarp cut in each field, went back to 6-hour intervals. In addition to the air samples, which I think if you add them all up, there were somewhere around 3,000 air samples, 1,500 for PIP and 1,500 for 1,3D. They each required different trapping medium. There was quite extensive soil sampling. Field one, 9 cores at 4 different depths, and fields 2 and 3, 4 cores at 4 different depths. And for each segment, we measured the soil water characteristic curve, texture, soil organic carbon, bulk density, and the initial water content. In addition, there was 4 cores taken in each field at the end of the study for the final post-study water contents. Soil gas sampling was conducted by USDA ARS. Siwan had, I think we used nine different sampling times there, 1.4, 2.4, and set that through 18.4 days. At the 0-centimeter depth, which was basically sampling the gas concentration between the tarp and the soil surface, there were 24 replicates in field one. And then we had 4 other depths that we used in the modeling where there were 12 replicates at 25, 45, 70, 100 centimeters. Meteorological data, environmental monitoring set up the MET station, and we collected our usual suite of MET data that we collect at for fumigant study. And it was novel that we had a surrogate plot set up adjacent to field one. In this plot, Atoch set up probes to measure temperature, barometric pressure, soil water content, and relative humidity as a function of depth. We were basically trying to collect all the data we could to characterize the site. This surrogate plot was subject to the same pre-irrigation, disking, and tarping identical to field one. It was right next to field one. The only difference being when the rig ran through the plot, no fumigant was injected. So part of this data was used for hydrous modeling, and then we collected some other data for diagnostic reasons. If the model didn't perform, we wanted to understand why. For example, could it be barometric pressure fluctuations responsible for model failure? So this is a picture of the fumigation rig, and so you can see this is a Nobel plow setup, and these plows come down and they have these wings, and there's basically two nozzles on each side of the wing. And so what happens is those are sunk down in the ground, and the application begins, the rig starts moving through the field, and at the same time behind it, tarp is unrolled. So it goes back and forth and back and forth, and there's overlap where the tarps are unrolled and those tarp edges are glued together. The application rate was fairly high, 570 pounds per acre of pit chlor 60. Part of the reason for this is we wanted to ensure that if we had, we wanted to ensure that we would measure air concentrations, because we weren't really sure how totally impermeable the film was going to be. On the left-hand side at the bottom, I'm showing you the hydrous initial condition. So basically, this is the soil profile in the model, and that's how I simulated the initial condition for the distribution of fumigant in the profile. And on the right-hand side, it's just a picture of the discretization of the soil materials. So the first layer, this light blue, is corresponds to the 0 to 20 centimeter soil samples. The next green layer is the 20 to 40, etc. So I think it would help in understanding what the model comparisons are going to mean to understand how back calculation or inverse modeling of fumigant flux works. So if we imagine we have a certain one by one meter square section of land, and there's fumigant coming out of it, the basic assumption is that fumigant concentration you measure at some off-site location is proportional to the flux coming out of the field. When I say flux, I'm really talking about flux density. So if you had a 100 pound of the acre application and you measured 2 parts per million or 2 micrograms per centimeter cubed off-site, then under identical conditions, if you had a 200 pound per application, we would expect 4 micrograms per centimeter off-site. So that's the central assumption. It's quite a reasonable assumption. What ISCST3 is, it's a dispersion model that requires you to tell it what the flux is, and that, along with the meteorological data that you supply, wind speed, direction, that kind of stuff, and the field geometry, the model predicts what air concentrations would be off-site. So the way we use ISCST3 is essentially to run it in an inverse mode, to run it backwards. The idea is, suppose that we had a field with 4 sampler locations. We never actually use 4, to my knowledge, but just for the sake of example. The idea is that we use ISCST3 to model air concentrations at those 4 locations using the actual site-specific met data and an assumed standard flux density of 1 microgram meter squared per second. So if we were to do this example, we would then end up with 2 columns of concentration data. We would have ISCST3 modeled air concentration at each location, modeled assuming a standard flux of 1, and we would have the measured data. And we would look at the data and say, well, you know, location 1, the value is about 0. Location 2, it looks like it's about an order of magnitude. It's about a factor of 10 greater. Location 3, it's about a factor of 10 greater, almost a factor of 10 greater at 4. So, hey, the flux must be 10 times greater than what we assumed when we ran ISCST3. In practice, though, of course, we don't sit around and look at the numbers and say, well, this looks like about 3. What we do is we perform linear regression. So these are actual data that relate measured concentration for chloropicrin, field number 2, interval 26, against the ISCST3 estimates generated using the assumed standard flux of 1. And the slope of that regression is 3.4, so what that tells us is that the measured values on the average are 3.4 times greater than what was predicted by ISC. And so the average flux is the slope of the plot, 3.4. But it doesn't always turn out this nice. This, for example, are the first six regressions for the six highest chloropicrin flux periods in field one. And you can see that the fit for the ISC versus measured air concentrations there's a lot of error in those fits. The R-squared values range as low as 0.25. What this translates to is uncertainty in the back-calculated flux. So with that, we can look at the actual back-calculated data. On the top, I'm showing the cumulative flux expressed as a percent of application for fields 1, 2, and 3. Now, we're interested in cumulative flux when we apply fumigants because of their contribution to VOCs. So we're interested in knowing the total amount of fumigant that comes back out of the ground when we apply it. So you can see the large flush that occurs with field 3 because it has the shortest tarp pit time. A lot of the fumigant hasn't degraded yet. In contrast, at fields 2 and 1, with the longer tarp pit times, the flushes at the end of those are really much smaller. And if we compare the emission ratios, again, which is the cumulative flux as a fraction of application, basically what's plotted on the y-axis, the emission ratios for chloropicrin here in these plots range from about 3 to 10%. And for the tarp cut time of 10 and 16 days, we're down around 3 or 4. This compares to about 34 to 62% in the one study I used for comparison here for polyethylene tarps. And these are for a comparable 10 to 14 day study. So it's about an order of magnitude less. So while the totally impermeable film is not, in fact not totally impermeable, it definitely has much lower permeability than polyethylene. If we look at the bottom plot, these are the flux densities, the average flux densities for either the 6-hour or 12-hour sampling periods. And notice that the y-axis is broken, somewhere from 8 to about 35. The maximum pre-cut flux densities for the three fields are in the range of 4 to 6, and these usually occur somewhere in the first 1, 2, or 3 days. So we're concerned about maximum flux densities. This is from an exposure standpoint. Because basically we use those maximum flux densities to set buffer zones. So in this case, we saw 4 to 6 micrograms per meter squared per second. If we have a similar application rate adjusted flux density for polyethylene tarps, ballpark figure would be something like 30. You can see that the maximum flux density, they vary by field, but there's a clear diurnal pattern. A lot of, for these particular chemicals, this is related to the temperature regime, the diurnal fluctuation in temperature. And it's evident that the post-tarp cut flux has decreased with holding time. Similarly, for 1,3-dichloropropane, emission ratios on the order of 9 to 20% for the 10 and 16 day, actually we're in the neighborhood of about 4 to 10, 4 to 9, something like that. So this compares favorably to at least the data I looked at, 26 to 65 for polyethylene tarps. Similarly, magnitude of the maximum flux is much lower, somewhere around an order of magnitude as compared to polyethylene, and the same pattern of decreasing flux, post-tarp cut flux with holding time. So those are the actual back-calculated results. So I'd like to talk a little bit now about how I compared hydrous and ISC estimated fluxes. I'll talk a little bit about previous validation studies, then I'll talk about hydrous calibration using the field one data, we're going to try and ask the question, what are the most important variables? Which of these variables can't be independently estimated? And how are we going to estimate them, or how are we going to calibrate the model using the field one data? Then I'll show the calibration results, and finally get down to the comparison. So to my knowledge, there's only been two papers that have claimed to validate fumigant transport models. And one of those looked only at gas concentrations, and so is really not relevant to what we're talking about here. And the other study basically looked at measured and modeled fluxes using historical registrant-generated data. And these are two examples of the plots that came out of that paper. On the left-hand side is a Shank application from Salinas, and the inset here is the cumulative flux profile, and then this is the period mean flux densities. And this is a Georgia drip application here, much poorer fit. And so what this study did is it compared the modeled and it compared the so-called measured fluxes and said, hey, they match pretty good, so the model's validated. Well, there's a couple problems here. First of all, we know that there's no measured fluxes. They aren't measured. These were determined by the aerodynamic method, another modeling technique based on measured air concentrations. But more importantly, there were no comparisons of soil gas, water content, soil temperature, and no mass balance information. So why is this important? Well, there's a lot of stuff happening in the soil. There's fumigant diffusing, it's partitioning between air, water, and soil, it's degrading, it's being held back and trying to diffuse through the tarp, and all of these processes are temperature dependent. So I thought the problem here is best described by a quote that I read in a modeling paper, 1981 modeling paper, that basically points out that when you have really complex simulation models with a lot of parameters and a lot of nonlinear relations, like hybris or anything else that describes fumigant behavior, those models have a lot of degrees of freedom, and you can manipulate the variables often to produce virtually any outcome you want, often using having plausible variables. So, for example, if we look at hydrus, there's a lot of stuff that goes into running the model. You have saturated water content, initial water content, all the hydraulic parameters, bulk density, soil thermal properties, i.e. heat capacity and heat diffusivity. And you need all those at all the different depths. Chemical properties, diffusion coefficient, partition coefficients, the temperature dependence of all those, KOC, tarp properties, mass transfer coefficient, other data. So the question really is, for us, is which of these are most important? Because some of these are really not very important as far as fumigant transport, others are really important. So to answer that question, we did a sensitivity analysis. And these are the results from that sensitivity analysis for the first 9 variables. We looked at, actually, 15. This was recently accepted for publication in the Edison Journal. And what this shows is basically a ranking of the most important variables that go into, among the ones we looked at, that go into the model. And so you don't have to worry about what the number on the right is. It's just basically gives the rank of how important those variables are. So saturated water content, initial water content, gas diffusion coefficient, Henry's law constant. Well, we measured the first two in the field, so this isn't an issue. We went out there and took some soil cores and measured these. We know what they are. The gas diffusion coefficient and the Henry's law constants, there are really well-developed theoretical methods to estimate these variables with a high degree of precision. The last two, the Henry's temperature dependence and the surface temperature fluctuation, the latter is measured. The former, again, there's really good thermodynamic methods to estimate that with a high degree of confidence. But the rub is the soil sorption coefficient, KOC, degradation rate constant, and tarp permeability factor. These in particular, these soil type parameters, are highly variable from study to study. The tarp permeability factor, we already know that the field, the laboratory data, does not describe well what happens in the field. So we would like to calibrate the model so that we end up with reasonable, plausible, accurate, site-specific estimates for these using field one data, then take those estimates and see if we can simulate fields two and three with completely independently derived parameters. So the way that we do this is, or the way that we did it, or the way that I did it anyway, you can use a procedure called nonlinear optimization, which basically asks the question, what values for the degradation rate constant, organic carbon, partition coefficient, and tarp mass transfer coefficient, which values of those could I find that would give me the best fit between hydrous simulation and the ISC estimated field one data, where by best fit, I'm trying to match cumulative flux, including post-tarp cut, which is important, and period mean flex densities. At the same time, we know we also want to accurately describe fumigant soil gas concentrations, temperature, and soil water contents, so that we have confidence that the model is actually simulating all the various processes with some degree of, so we have some confidence in that. After calibration, then, we take that calibrated model and we go to these other two fields, which are in the same general location and same type of soil type, and we simulate those using hydrous with completely independently determined parameters. So these are the results of the calibration. So what I'm doing is I'm fiddling around with the first order mass transfer coefficient for the tarp and the degradation rate and KOC, and I'm tuning the model to try and make it match the ISC estimated values for field one as best I can. So first start off on the right-hand side. PIC is on the top. 1,3-D is on the bottom. What we see is an excellent fit over both of the cumulative flux profiles, and we're also able to match the post-tarp cut little bumps that we get. Now, this is important because it's an indication that we're accurately describing degradation. Both the model and the field we see have comparable, looks like they have comparable amounts remaining in the profile at the time of tarp cut, 16 days. Now, if we go back to the period mean flux densities over here on the left, we see that the maximum values, which we're interested in, between hydrous and the back calculation method are roughly comparable, and they're certainly within the range of error that we would expect from ISC. However, there's a consistent issue here, a consistent problem, and you see that in both cases, on day one, we have much higher fluxes in the back calculation method as compared to hydrous. And so what this suggests, if this is real, it suggests that hydrous has some kind of delayed transport to the surface. It's not fully describing the rate of transport from the zone of application to the surface. So how do the temperature data look? Well, what we do, we have measured data that we put into the surface and we let hydrous predict what goes on all the way down through the soil profile. And here I just use default values for soil thermal conductivity and the heat parameters. And so the bottom line is basically the model nailed the temperature regime of the soil. Excellent reproduction of what was actually measured at the 10 centimeter depth and at the 30 centimeter depth. There's a little bit of deviation at 50 and 70 centimeters. And I could have tuned those heat capacity parameters and stuff to make that fit, but we're talking about a difference of like a degree centigrade. So I said, this is really not important because the action's taking place between 30 and 10 centimeters, 30 centimeters in the surface anyway.
Question?
Yeah.
In order to have tuned it, though, you would have had to change some of the soil properties?
No, I would have I would have done the nonlinear optimization on the soil heat capacity and the soil conductivity.
So the soil heat capacities and so on are kind of from the table lookup or something like that?
I use the default values.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly, yeah. And so, I mean, the match was so good, I could see no reason to waste time on it. This is a rich data set, so it's easy to get lost in it.
Yeah.
So these are the gas concentrations, and it's important to me that these match pretty well, because they basically tell me whether the partitioning among the different phases is accurately represented by the model. Here we have surface or under tarp gas concentrations. On the right-hand side, 25 centimeter, down below 45 and 70 centimeters. This is for PIC, chloropicrin. And I put in the RMSD, root mean squared deviation, just as a measure of how much different the hydrous simulations were at each depth than the measured data. And these are calculated from the means of the measured data. And, you know, all told, I think that the fits are pretty good. In most cases, hydrous is within the error bars. However, the important thing I think that this plot shows is, again, the peak at the surface occurs later than it does in the measured data. So for chloropicrin, we have a delayed peak, even though it's within the error bar. It suggests that's the case. Similarly, at 25 centimeters, which is close to the zone of injection, we have higher concentrations immediately than are actually measured. And this may have something to do with delayed transport. Similarly, the data for 1,3-D show the same type of pattern where you have delayed peak at the surface and also high concentrations early on at the 25-centimeter depth. But I have to say, all told, I'm really quite pleased. I was really surprised that the model was able to provide data this close to the measured data, provide output or predictions. Finally, this is the end of study water content by field. I had this for all three fields. And so basically what these data show is that most cases, at four different depths, in most cases, the model was well within the measured standard deviation of the water contents. It's a little bit drier in field one, but still pretty close, and also in field three. So one of the really novel things to this study, and I've never seen this in any other study, was because we had that gas concentration, it allowed me to calculate a mass budget. So I could compare what the actual measured field data predicted for the mass budget and what hydrous predicted. So the way I did this was, of course, I have the volatilized amount, and this is what those gas data allowed me to calculate. With the gas concentrations all through the profile at 18 days at the end of the study, then I went ahead and I was able to calculate from the gas concentrations how much was in gas, how much was in the water, how much was in the soil, add it all up and figure out how much is left as a percent of application. And if I do this with 1,3-D, I conclude that 89% of the applied 1,3-D is either degraded or transported below 100 centimeters, below my lowest gas sampling depth. I can't tell how much is degraded. I can't tell how much is transported beyond 100 centimeters with the measured data, but I'm able to come up, or the field estimator data, I'm able to come up with that estimate of the mass budget. In contrast, I do the same thing with hydrous, and I come up with very similar numbers, but what hydrous is predicting is that transport beyond 100 centimeters is really a very small portion of the application. And I come up with the same similar type of data with PIC, where I get about 0.2%. And basically, both the field estimates and hydrous are predicting somewhere between 90 and 95% degradation or minor contribution from deep transport. So this is all calibration. So as a result of this calibration, then generally what we saw was pretty good agreement between Hydrus and ISC flux estimates, including the post-tarp cut emission ratio. I'm hitting soil temperature, soil water content, soil gas fairly well. There is a tendency for delayed transport to the surface in the Hydrus simulations. And the best fit parameters, at least for the degradation half-life and the KOC, are well within the range of the estimates that we would see in the literature. So what are the simulations for the fields 2 and 3 look like? Now remember, these are completely independent simulations. They didn't use any, there's no fitting or anything like that going on. So for cumulative flux, this is field number 2 in, with PIC, and field number 2 with 1-3-D, we see that we have a little bit higher hydrous simulated flux, but, you know, we're talking about a range of 2 to 3% of the application. So we're pretty close to the pixels with this data. We get a similar kind of bump post-application. Like similarly, for 1-3-D, we're talking about, what, 5 to 6.5% of the application, so the numbers are pretty close. If we look at the maximum flux densities, basically they're comparable in both cases, but again, we're seeing that this initial flush or this initial day one or day two peak in flux density is not simulated by Hydrus, so we're again seeing some kind of a delay, or it's not quite simulating transport as fast as it should. Similarly, for 1-3-D, pretty good agreement in the cumulative flux profile for both chemicals. We're matching the post-tarp cut emission ratios fairly good. Notice that the axis is broken in both these plots, so these are very high emission ratios we see for the 5-day tarp cut, which is what this is. And our pre-tarp cut flux ratios, the maximums, are really comparable to what's being observed or what's being estimated from the field data. So to summarize the comparisons of the two, what I did was just calculate the mean absolute difference in emission ratios, the mean absolute difference based on field 2 and field 3. And it's less than 1%. Also, I looked at the mean absolute percent difference in maximum flux density. 28% for field 2 and 3 is the average of the percent difference between Hydrus and that calculation method. Well within, I would guess, the error in the back calculation method. One of the problems in making these comparisons is that there really isn't a lot of information on how much uncertainty there is in back calculation. You go to literature and you read something like Jim Seiber will say, well, the back calculation method can generally estimate fluxes within a factor of 2, but that's all opinion. We don't really understand what the error is, so it makes it difficult to interpret the comparison. Similarly to chloropicrin, the mean absolute emission ratio difference is less than 1%, and we had about a 15% mean percent difference in maximum flux, which, again, is likely within the error of uncertainty of the back calculation method. So the conclusions are that TIF is not a totally impermeable film, but it's certainly much lower permeability than polyethylene. Tarp cut time, the standard 5-day tarp cut is probably going to be problematic, so we're going to come up with department or EPA or everybody's got to come up with different tarp cut time. In calibration mode, Hydrus did a good job with simulating soil water content, gas concentrations, temperature, fumigant fate, and fluxes, and this is all simultaneous, so it's pretty much at least representing what's going on in the profile in a reasonable way. In the in the so-called validation step, simulated the emission ratio and the magnitude of the maximum flux in those fields 2 and 3 with independent parameterization. So that was pretty cool. However, there was this persistent issue of a delayed transport to the surface, and shown by both the gas concentrations and the timing of the maximum flux peak was usually late by about 1 day. I have several ideas why this might be, but we're not really sure at this point. The study was novel and included mass balance and conventional model calibration validation comparisons, and neither one of these really have been seen in literature as far as I know. Quantitative flux comparisons between hydrous and other field-based methods are really difficult, and the reason is because we really don't understand the magnitude of uncertainty very well in the inverse modeling or other field-based type flux estimates. So I went through a lot of months being really frustrated trying to figure out what kind of comparisons I was making and what the comparisons really meant. And so as part of that frustration, when I made my first slide for the presentation, for this presentation, that was going to be my title slide, I called it Compared to What? But then I finally decided maybe that wasn't appropriate for a scientific presentation. So anyway, that's what my...